welcome back, and ever so briefly, we have this lovely boardroom in the Institute for Church Life, courtesy of Dr. John Cavadini. Here he is, and he just edited a book back in the fall of 2012, and he's giving it to Pope Benedict. And the book was on Benedict the theologian. So several of the faculty members and visitors from here contributed to that book. So that's Dr. Cavadini, and I simply want to stress he regrets he can't be with us, but he is with the bishops in St. Louis as they meet with their doctrinal committee. And what I know of Dr. Cavadini, I can say with great clarity and deep conviction in my heart, having studied with him, he's absolutely faithful and understands the meaning of the Magisterium. And his task, since 2002 with the bishops, has been to expand their understanding of issues that pertain to some of the burning pastoral questions that we have in our country today. He is an absolutely marvelous man. He's got seven children and just a beautiful family. But I thought that it was most appropriate to talk about his loyalty to the Magisterium because Monsignor Calkins is going to speak on that.
Thank you, Father. I don't know, and I don't know whether any of you do, how I was assigned this topic, Father Peter Damian Fehlner and the Magisterium. I was late in trying to get my thoughts together and what to do. And one could hardly treat even an overview in a few minutes on Father Peter Damian's insights and ways of explaining the Magisterium. So my topic is much more humble and limited. It's entitled The Franciscan Thesis as presented by Father Peter Damian Fehlner and the Magisterium. And I'm sure Father Peter could fill in many parts of what I'm just sketching very briefly in the first part, because this paper is divided into three parts. The Franciscan Thesis as articulated by Father Peter Damian, the Franciscan Thesis as it is entered into the Magisterium, and thirdly, conclusions. Very modest. In the course of almost 30 years, I've learned a great deal about Mariology from Father Peter Damian Fehlner. He is a disciple and master of that uniquely Franciscan approach to the doctrine of the joint predestination of Jesus and Mary, known as the Franciscan Thesis. His exposition of this doctrine on the Mariology and scholarly achievement of Father Juniper B. Carroll, 1911 to 1990, at the Convention of the Mariological Society of America in 1992, made a deep impression on me. In introducing the contribution of Father Juniper Carroll, he found it appropriate to treat of the accomplishment of Father Juniper's master and guide in the field of Franciscan Mariology, Father Carlo Balich, 1899 to 1977. And as you may know, Father Balich was one of the two final redactors of Chapter 8 of Lumen Gentium. Here I'm quoting Father Peter on Father Balich. Father Balich's contribution to Mariology is therefore unabashedly Franciscan in inspiration. It takes its cue from the so-called Franciscan thesis, the absolute primacy of the Word incarnate, parenthesis, kingship of Christ, and His Blessed Mother's association, uno eodemque decreto, in that primacy, parenthesis, qua Immaculate Queen of Heaven and Earth. An association particularly evident at three points in the life of the Virgin, her conception, her cooperation in the work of salvation, her triumph in heaven, or put doctrinally, the Immaculate Conception, the universal maternal mediation of Mary, and her glorious assumption and coronation in heaven as Queen of the universe. The allusion, of course, to uno eodemque decreto is a shorthand reference to the famous text wherein the Franciscan thesis passed into the Papal Magisterium in Blessed Pius IX's Apostolic Constitution Ineffabilis Deus, in which he solemnly declared the dogma of the Immaculate Conception. In that authoritative document, Pius stated that God, by one and the same decree, had established the origin of Mary and the incarnation of divine wisdom. Ad ilius virginis primordia transfere, quae uno eodemque decreto cum divine sapientia incarnatione fuerunt praestituta. This is to say that from all eternity, in willing the incarnation of the Word, the second person of the Most Blessed Trinity, God also willed Mary. This may seem to be a simple and obvious statement in itself, until one begins to realize that God could have brought the incarnation about in any way that he wished, since he needed no one to accomplish it, but he willed to need Mary. I put need in quotation marks. This is what Saint Louis de Montfort refers to as the, now it escapes me, God's relative willingness. That's not the word I want, but hypothetical necessity. He calls Mary a hypothetical necessity. This position is based on the union of the woman of Genesis 3:15 with her offspring, which is obviously a foundation of this Franciscan thesis. This position together, though not on an equal par, they will overcome the serpent. But first of all, they are willed for themselves as the crown of material creation. Thus, as Father Peter Damian tells us, the joint predestination of Jesus and Mary is at the very center of the divine counsels of salvation. And for this reason, as we've been hearing, the mode of the incarnation is Marian, not only in its first moment, but in every moment, above all, the last. This statement, then, by Blessed Pius IX in Ineffabilis Deus, marks the first time that this position, long sustained and taught by Franciscan theologians, entered into the papal magisterium. This theological conviction, in fact, is not original to Franciscan theologians, because, as Father Peter Damian explains, its roots antedate both Scotus and Francis himself. It is Franciscan not by reason of origin, in this it is rather Catholic, but by reason of its promotion, of its being rendered more explicit and then more effectively incorporated into the life of the Church, as Maximilian Kolbe would say. The statement that Father Peter makes in parentheses is very important. This position is ultimately Catholic, and we owe our gratitude to the Franciscan family for having consistently sustained it and taught it. Ultimately, as he explains, Mary in some intrinsic manner pertains as no other person to the order of the hypostatic union, the grace of graces, and source of all order and intelligibility, both in the economy of salvation and creation. To this fact, and to the special place enjoyed by Mary in the economy of salvation, both in relation to the mystery of Jesus and the Church, Lumen Gentium chapter 8, title, the whole of Revelation affords abundant witness, as sketched out in Lumen Gentium numbers 55 and following. In the first part of this article, the predestination of his magisterial article, the predestination of the Virgin Mary and her Immaculate Conception, in the Mariology volume edited by Dr. Mark Miravalle, Father Peter laments the fact that treatment of the predestination of Mary has all but disappeared from Mariological study. We are grateful that his study in that volume once more presents it to a wide audience. From the perspective of Blessed John Duns Scotus, 1266 circa to 1308, whose faithful disciple Father Peter has ever remained, he explains that, whereas the fullness of grace in Mary is in view of the foreseen merits of her Son, the participation in grace by all others is in view of the mediation of Jesus and Mary. Because of the fact of sin on the part of Adam and Eve, that mediation of Christ, when realized historically after the tragic event of original sin and the fall of the angels, is in fact redemptive as well as saving. Preservatively in Mary, parenthesis, and in a subordinate way in the angels who did not fall, and liberatively in all others. In Mary, redemption is her Immaculate Conception. In us, it is our liberation from sin. In both cases, redemption is the term of divine mercy. More perfectly, however, in Mary than in us, and in us dependently on its realization in the Immaculate. Father Peter goes on to underscore a point overlooked by the critics of SCOTUS. In the joint predestination of Jesus and Mary, the distinctive personal roles of Jesus and Mary are not confused, nor does their coordination with a single work of mediation put Mary on a par with Jesus. This, of course, is the screaming fear of all of the anti-co-redemptionists. Any more than the capacity of the blessed to think and love in the mode of divine persons, parenthesis, a kind of coordination anticipated in the divine indwelling by grace, puts them on a par with the divine persons. Such coordination, heart of the supernatural order of grace, rests ever on a radical subordination. In this joint predestination, Jesus is ordained absolutely for his own sake, and Mary for the sake of Jesus and no other, not even herself. Yet in virtue of the very grace of the Immaculate Conception, whereby she totally belongs to Jesus and to the Church as Mother, she is ennobled in a most personal way, thereby revealing how grace transforms and perfects the person. While it would be possible to outline Father Peter Damian's thought on this topic more extensively, I'd leave it to him, of course, I trust that this serves as a useful foundation. One can find more in the vast number of Mariological works that he has written, especially in his article in the Mariology volume, although there may be many others hidden away that I'm not aware of. Now my second point, the confirmation of the thesis in the Magisterium. And this is where I hope to make a very modest contribution. Since the statement by Blessed Pius IX that by one and the same decree God established the incarnation of divine wisdom and the origin of Mary, this conviction has been restated on numerous occasions in the papal and conciliar magisterium. It is true that they have not all been stated at the highest level of the magisterium, such as in a doctrinal definition or in an encyclical. Nonetheless, each restatement is in concord with the others while enriching the doctrine with further valuable nuances. I will present here, which is more common knowledge, as well as what I have subsequently discovered. I can make no pretense of having discovered all of the restatements of this theme in the Magisterium, but simply of providing data that confirms the so-called Franciscan thesis is no longer a thesis, or perhaps I should say, is no longer an hypothesis, but is truly the Catholic position. So my first example, I give 15. The most important restatement of the position stated by Blessed Pius IX, after that occasion, as far as I know, occurs in the Apostolic Constitution of the Venerable Pius XII, Munificentissimus Deus, of the 1st of November, 1950, in which he solemnly defined the bodily assumption of the Blessed Virgin Mary into heaven. In that apostolic constitution, he states, "The revered Mother of God, from all eternity, joined in a hidden way with Jesus Christ in one and the same decree of predestination. He uses uno eodemque decreto predestinationis arcano modo conjuncta. Hidden but true. The next three restatements occur in Lumen Gentium, the dogmatic constitution on the Church promulgated on the 21st of November 1964. In number 53, we hear that Mary, redeemed by reason of the merits of her Son and united to him by a close and indissoluble tie, is united with the high office and dignity of being the mother of the Son of God. The Latin is intuitu meritorum filii sui sublimiore modo redempta eique arcto et dissolubili vinculo unita. Canon lawyers may recognize the language here of the indissolubilis nexus, which makes a genuinely ratified and consummated marriage indissoluble. So here he is not using the word, or the fathers are not using the word predestined, but they're insisting that the connection is unbreakable. Indissolubilis nexus. The next reference occurs in Lumen Gentium 56. The Father of Mercies willed that the incarnation should be preceded by the acceptance of her who was predestined to be the mother of his Son, so that just as a woman contributed to death, so also a woman should contribute to life. Voluit autem misericordiarum pater, ut acceptatio predestinate matris incarnationem precederet. So there we do have the term again, predestination. I will just mention that many years ago, when I was young and rather ignorant and studying at Oxford, I got into some difficult discussions with a learned scripture scholar who was also a hardline Calvinist, insisting that the only predestination known in the New Testament is predestination to glory, and the only predestination the Church talks about is predestination to glory. There is no predestination to hell. That's a free choice. The third occurrence of this doctrine in the same dogmatic constitution is to be found in number 61, where the Virgin Mary is described as predestined from eternity to be the Mother of God by that decree of divine providence which determined the incarnation of the Word. Beata Virgo ab aeterno unicum divini verbi incarnatione tamquam mater Dei predestinata divine providentiae consilio. So three times in Lumen Gentium we have the predestination of Mary in union with Jesus. And it occurs once again in the Second Vatican Council, this time in Sacrosanctum Concilium, the Council's Constitution on the Sacred Liturgy, number 103. In celebrating this annual cycle of Christ's mysteries, Holy Church honors with especial love the Blessed Mary, Mother of God, who is joined by an inseparable bond to the saving work of her Son. And that Latin is cum peculiari amore venerator quae indissolubili nexu cum filii sui opere salutari coniungitur. One wonders if dear Father Bolich had a hand in some of these. He couldn't get everything he wanted, but I'm sure he worked to put in whatever he could, whenever he could, and God bless him for that. The sixth indication we find in the Professio Fidei, often called the Credo of the People of God, of Blessed Paul VI. And he simply states that Mary is joined by a close and indissoluble bond to the mystery of the incarnation and redemption. Acto et indissolubili vinculo mysterio incarnationis et redemptionis conjuncta. So we've got actually four instances, at least as I read them, in the Second Vatican Council. In his general audience address of the 30th of May, 1973, Blessed Paul VI referred to Mary in this way. And what human cooperation has been chosen in the history of our Christian destinies, first in function, dignity, and efficiency, not purely instrumental and physical, but as a predestined, though free and perfectly docile factor, if not that of Mary? Now, this is the complex rhetoric of Paolo VI, but he's answering his question by making some very interesting specifications. E quale cooperazione umana è stata eletta nella storia dei nostri destini cristiani prima per funzione, per dignità, per efficienza, non puramente strumentale e fisica, ma come fattore predestinato, ma libero e perfettamente docile, se non quella di Maria. It's a classic Montini, very specific. Our final text from Paul VI comes from Mariali's Cultus of the 2nd of February, 1974, number 25. It likewise seems to us fitting that these expressions of devotion should reflect God's plan, which laid down with one single decree the origin of Mary and the incarnation of divine wisdom. And here the conclusive part is, cum divine sapientiae incarnatione fuerunt prestituta, where he's quoting from Pius IX. The first text that I want to present from the Magisterium of Pope St. John Paul II come from his Marian encyclical Redemptoris Mater of the 25th of March, 1987. Now, I was thinking in the plane on the way here that one could go to his first encyclical Redemptor Hominis, in which he says, no one can lead us into the mystery of Christ as Mary can, because no one has been led into it as she was. So it's a somewhat oblique reference to the joint predestination. And likewise, in Dives in Misericordia, oh, I'm so loud, you might have picked me up anyhow. Thank you. He also says, no one has been led into the mystery of God's mercy as Mary has, speaking of her Immaculate Conception, which eventually includes her predestination. But I'm beginning here with number 8 of Redemptoris Mater. In the mystery of Christ, she is present even before the creation of the world, as the one whom the Father has chosen as mother of his Son in the Incarnation. And what is more, together with the Father, the Son has chosen her, entrusting her eternally to the Spirit of Holiness. In an entirely special and exceptional way, Mary is united to Christ, and similarly, she is eternally loved in this beloved Son, this Son who is of one being with the Father, in whom is concentrated all the glory of grace. It's a very powerful statement, but this encyclical has to be read, I think, a half a dozen times to really allow its depths to begin to sink in. And it's interesting, in the Latin, it's rather direct. Maybe it wasn't translated by Reggie Foster, who used to like to make things as complicated as possible. In mysterio Christi, ea est presens iam ante mundi constitutionem. Now this brings to mind the use of certain sapiential texts from the books of wisdom in the former liturgy of the church, enshrined, we might say, in the 1962 Roman Missal, where very often the first reading, called the epistle, although it wasn't an epistle, was from these readings about divine wisdom. The Lord possessed me in the beginning of his ways. Before he made anything from the beginning, I was set up from eternity. Dominus possedit me in initio viarum suarum, ante quam quidquam faceret a principio. Now, of course, the early fathers of the church read these wisdom texts as a reference to the second person of the Blessed Trinity. But by the same token, as time went on, in a secondary and subordinate sense, it was also understood of Mary, through whom the Word became flesh. So, John Paul is saying that from all eternity she is in the mind of God. He knows what he will do, how he will do it, the order in which he will do it, which of course is all very scotistic. Of course, this reading, all right, my second is number 9 in that same encyclical. And again, it's not terribly easy to enter into, but it is profound. If the greeting in the name full of grace say all this, in the context of the angel's announcement, they refer first of all to the election of Mary as mother of the Son of God. But at the same time, the fullness of grace indicates all the supernatural munificence from which Mary benefits by being chosen and destined to be the mother of Christ. So again, we have this predestination in Christ. I won't read all of the Latin. Here the Pope strives to draw out the meaning of cacaritomene, the term rendered in Latin as gratia plena. This, he says, indicates all the supernatural munificence from which Mary benefits, precisely because she was chosen and destined to be the Mother of God. Here, again, is the way that Father Peter Damian puts it, and it acts, I believe, as a good commentary here. Because of the fact of sin on the part of Adam and Eve, that mediation of Christ, when realized historically after the tragic event of original sin and the fall of the angels, is in fact redemptive as well as saving, preservatively in Mary, liberatively in all others. In Mary, redemption is her Immaculate Conception. In us, it is our liberation from sin. Finally, in number 10 of Redemptoris Mater, the Pope continues the argument. From the first moment of her conception, which is to say of her existence, she belonged to Christ, sharing in the salvific and sanctifying grace, in that love which has its beginning in the Beloved, the Son of the Eternal Father, who through the Incarnation became her own Son. Consequently, through the power of the Holy Spirit in the order of grace, which is a participation in the divine nature, Mary receives life from him to whom she herself, in the order of earthly generation, gave life as a mother. From the first moment of her existence, the Pope argues, Mary belongs to Christ, and therefore with Christ. And yet Christ does not exist in his humanity because he has not yet taken flesh in her womb. The mystery is great. Mary receives life from him to whom she herself, in the order of earthly generation, gave life as a mother. All of this, I would submit, draws out the statement of Blessed Pius IX about the one and same divine decree. Number 10. In his general audience address of the 23rd of November, 1988, St. John Paul II once again touched on the joint predestination of Jesus and Mary. And he says, in this gift made to John and through him to Christ's followers and to all mankind, there is, as it were, a completion of the gift which Jesus made of himself to humanity by his death on the cross. Mary is, as it were, and here I change the translation, entirely one with him. The Italian is tutt'una, and the translator had made it all one, which I don't think sounds very good in English. I think entirely one captures the idea in the Italian, all entirely one with Jesus, not only because they are mother and son according to the flesh, but because in God's eternal plan they are contemplated, predestined, and situated together at the center of the history of salvation. Very strong language, very direct and scholastic for a man like John Paul II. It was, Maria costituisce con lui un tutt'uno, non solo perché sono madre e figlio, secondo la carne, ma perché nell'eterno disegno di Dio sono contemplati, predestinati, collocati insieme al centro della storia della salvezza. Quite beautiful. Number 11, in number 78 of his apostolic letter, Dies Domini, of the 31st of May, 1998, Pope John Paul II made this statement. Likewise, in celebrating the annual cycle of the mysteries of Christ, the Holy Church venerates with special love the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, united forever with the saving work of her Son. Quae indissolubili nexu cum filio suo opere salutare coniungitur. That's a quotation of Sacrosanctum Concilium number 103. Direct quote. But again, you've got the indissoluble bond. The last one, I believe, that I have here from John Paul II is on December 8th, 2004. It was his last celebration of the Feast of the Immaculate Conception, and it was the 150th anniversary of the dogma of the Immaculate Conception. So he says, the predestination of Mary, like that of each one of us, is linked to the predestination of the Son. Christ is that seed that was to bruise the head of the ancient serpent, according to the book of Genesis. He is the Lamb without blemish, immolated to redeem humanity from sin. With a view to the saving death of the Son, Mary, his mother, was preserved free from original sin and from every other sin. The victory of the new Adam also includes that of the new Eve, mother of the redeemed. The Immaculate Virgin is thus a sign of hope for all the living who have triumphed over Satan by the blood of the Lamb. I won't read it all in Italian, but he begins, la predestinazione di Maria come quella di ognuno di noi è relativa alla predestinazione del figlio. Now, in this homily, he clearly states that the predestination of Mary is linked to that of Christ, as is our predestination. He doesn't clarify here, but the joint predestination of Jesus and Mary, however, is prior to ours in God's plan. Here, John Paul links the joint predestination to the very fundamental scriptural text of Genesis 3:15, the Proto-Evangelium, and accepts the present prevailing interpretation that it is the seed of the woman who crushes the serpent, as opposed to the Vulgate translation of St. Jerome, which has the woman crushing the serpent. On another occasion, John Paul pointed out that Genesis 3:15 must still be understood as referring to Mary's sharing in the conflict with Satan and her sharing in the victory of Christ, albeit in a secondary and subordinate way, totally dependent on Christ. Now, it may be worth mentioning, I think, the whole question of Genesis 3:15 is one that still deserves consideration, and the question of the translation. Because the she will crush has prevailed in the church from Saint Jerome to the pontificate of John Paul II. With the Neo Vulgata, it was changed. Father Settimio Manelli, I think, did a brilliant study on this and points out that all of the modern studies stand in sharp contrast with a tradition of well over 1,500 years. And one wonders whether we needed the Neo Vulgata. That's another matter. I've made some indications in the footnotes. Quite clearly, Jesus is the victory over Satan, But Mary is predestined to share in that struggle. Now, it may also be helpful to indicate that John Paul II's primary optic was that of Calvary, always. And so there are also numerous texts in which he discusses the joint predestination of Jesus and Mary, primarily in terms of the joint suffering on Calvary of Jesus, the new Adam, and Mary, the new Eve. I did not include such texts, but there are many. And they follow, obviously, from the joint predestination in the mind of God and carry that out. Even Paul VI says it in his Professio Fidei, that predestination carries over into her active collaboration in the work of the redemption. Number 13, the 8th of December 2006, when Pope Benedict XVI went to the Piazza di Spagna for the annual homage given to Our Lady and the statue of the Immaculate Conception. And the Pope says, "Full of grace are you, Mary, full of divine love from the very first moment of your existence, providentially predestined to be mother of the Redeemer and intimately connected to him in the mystery of salvation. Tu sei Maria, colma dell'amore divino dal primo istante della tua esistenza, providenzialmente predestinata ad essere la madre del Redentore ed intimamente associata a lui nel mistero della salvezza." I won't put the German accent in it. All right. It would be something like, well, we won't go into that. All right. In his Angelus address of the 15th of August 2007, Benedict stated, "Today we are celebrating the solemnity of the Assumption of the Blessed Virgin Mary. This is an ancient feast deeply rooted in sacred scripture. Indeed, it presents the Virgin Mary closely united to her divine Son and ever supportive of him. Mother and Son appear closely bound in the fight against the infernal enemy until they completely defeat him. This victory is expressed in particular in overcoming sin and death, that is, in triumphing over the enemies which St. Paul always presents as connected. The venerable Pope Pius XII declared, hence the revered Mother of God from all eternity, joined in a hidden way with Jesus Christ, is one and the same decree of predestination, immaculate in her conception, a most perfect virgin in her divine motherhood, the noble associate of the divine Redeemer who has won a complete triumph." All right, now I found the Italian almost hard to translate. I looked at it originally, and he has, "Questa infatti presenta la Vergine Maria strettamente unita al suo figlio divino e sempre a lui solidale." And it's saying the same thing almost twice, but doubly. And so the English translation just has united and doesn't bother trying to deal with solidale because it's difficult. And then he quotes, of course, Pius XII from Munificentissimus Deus. The final text that I cite in this florilegium is from Benedict XVI's homily on the 7th of September 2008 at the Shrine of Our Lady of Bonaria in Cagliari, Sardinia. The predestination of Mary is inscribed in the predestination of Jesus, as likewise is that of every human person. The "Here I am" of the Mother faithfully echoes the "Here I am" of the Son, as does the "Here I am" of all adoptive children in the Son, that of us all, precisely. Nella predestinazione di Gesù è inscritta la predestinazione di Maria come pura quella di ogni persona umana. Nell'eccomi del Figlio trova l'eco fedele l'eccomi della Madre, come anche l'eccomi di tutti i figli adottivi nel figlio di tutti noi, appunto. Now, it is a statement of the priority of the joint predestination, which at the same time is meant to include that of all believers. He doesn't make that distinction. I don't think he would deny it, but he simply includes us because we're all in the mind of God too, but after the predestination of Jesus and Mary. Okay, four conclusions. While this survey of the Franciscan thesis, as presented by Father Peter Damian and confirmed in the Papal and Conciliar Magisterium from 1854 to 2007, has been a relatively brief one, I believe that it is possible to draw some conclusions. One, the period of the Magisterium, which I have briefly analyzed, covers over 150 years. While what I presented here may not be exhaustive, it is definitively representative. Anyone contesting the concept of the joint predestination of Jesus and Mary at this stage in history would be opposing a well-established development of the doctrine, which I believe is grounded in Genesis 3:15. Authentic Catholic doctrine develops, but it does not go backwards. It does not negate. Two, for this reason, I do not think it necessary any longer to speak of the Franciscan thesis, or maybe I should have said hypothesis, because the thesis has been confirmed by the Magisterium many times over with consistency and further nuances. Shall we call it a fundamental Franciscan contribution to Christology and Mariology? It's interesting, too. Franciscan Mariology is unique, insofar as I understand. There is no Dominican Mariology. There is no Mariology of any other order that I'm aware of that is as consistent and further developed as Franciscan Mariology. And through a whole host of saints, Bernardine of Siena, Anthony of Padua, Lawrence of Brindisi, etc. And of course, Maximilian Kolbe. Three, the doctrine of the joint predestination of Jesus and Mary provides very significant corroboration of the dogma of the Immaculate Conception as it has ever since passed into the Magisterium in Ineffabilis Deus of 1854. It also upholds the primordial significance of Genesis 3:15 in the history of salvation and the doctrine of Marian co-redemption. Four, and finally, after Fathers Carlo Balich, OFM, Juniper Carroll, OFM, and their colleagues of the past, I believe that Father Peter Damian Fehlner, FI, has done more to make the present generation aware of this Franciscan contribution to Christology and Mariology than anyone else, especially in the English-speaking world. In what is perhaps his single major contribution on this matter, he tells us candidly, the treatment of the predestination of Mary has disappeared from Mariological study. But largely thanks to him, that is no longer the case.
I'm running just a little behind, and I leave Father Peter, would you like to make a brief comment on this?
Maybe it seemed like a minor contribution, but this flow relationship is very important because no other exists. Mm. I was aware of all the texts, but not in the constituted in order 15, self-supported. Second point, we don't realize how important for theology is the mind of God first, and then the execution of the plan. It's the only way that we can have a theology that can pretend to be realistic, and hence the study, by implication, of course, as were the texts adduced by the old Franciscans from Scripture, especially the New Testament, St. Paul, are in fact tests which support the absolute primacy and the joint predestination of Jesus and Mary. And that's important for realizing that we can't get beyond certain limits in philosophy unless we have the prior revelation of the mind of God. Philosophy ends, that is, the end of examination of what God has accomplished, where theology begins with the plan of God guiding us and determining what is and is not appropriate. In the language of the Scotus, what is dacit, not debe, but de. The potest, 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 potest,
The decoit. The decoit.
Decoit, yeah, yep. Should be. Bodo decoit ergo feature.
Okay, I'm going to say thank you, and we're going to break for 5 minutes, and then Professor David Bentley Hart is going to address us with the keynote. Okay.